Coming to the little, in not let us not go into detail, but a little structure activity, relationships. So the regions appear to create the ligand binding pocket analogies to that formed by the membrane spanning regions of the rhodopsin, a protein, to accumulate the covalently attached chromophore retinal with molecular models of the catecholamine. So there is a ligand binding packet on the particular receptors, and these receptors do have a very specific protein, whereas the beta adrenergic receptor, the three beta adrenergic receptors share approximately 60% of amino acid sequence. Already it is dealt within the presumed membrane spanning domains. The ligand binding packet it has got, and based on the results of site directed mutagenesis, individual amino acids in the beta 2 adrenergic receptor, they are going to interact with each of functional groups on catecholamine agonist molecule. These are identified because of the advanced techniques. Yes, thus the protonated amino group of the ligand appears to form a salt bridge between the acidic amino acid, that's aspartate 113, in the third transaminase spanning up of the domain. The ASP reduced is converted in all biological amines receptor. The example, biological amine means adrenergic, dopaminergic, muscarinic, cholinergic, and serotonergic receptors. So this is a very common residue. So interestingly, the rhodopsin or retinal is covalently attached to the lysine 296 in the helix 7, but presumed counter ion for the skiff ways provided by the side chain of GLU113 located on helical turn above the position of this ASP aspartate in the beta receptor in the helix 3. This is about the structure activity relationships. How, what is the structure of the adrenaline, and then how it's going to fit with that of the receptor, different type of the receptors, or the residues with transmembrane domains have been found to particularly involved in antagonistic reaction. For example, ASN312 in helix 7 appears to interact with phenoxy oxygen found in many most of the potent beta adrenergic antagonists. So this is the structure activity relationship, and all beta adrenergic receptors stimulate the adrenal cyclase via interaction, or especially with G stimulatory type of the protein. All beta adrenergic receptors do have the relation with that of the adrenal cyclase, whereas the all beta adrenergic receptors stimulate the adrenal cyclase by via interaction with G stimulatory protein. Then in addition, G stimulatory proteins can enhance directly the activation of voltage sensitive calcium channels in the plasma membrane of skeletal and cardiac muscles, and this action may provide an additional means of regulating the function of these tissues, especially the certain tissues where excitatory action is initiated. Whereas the cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase or PKC is considered major intracellular receptor for cyclic AMP, and the cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase generally is considered the major intracellular receptor for cyclic AMP, and all the sequential actions are initiated by binding of the adrenaline or norepinephrine to the specific type of the receptors. Maybe activation of G protein, then there is incoming flow of the calcium, and also adenosine monophosphate is converted to adenosine triphosphate, then cyclic AMP, and so many cascade of events it is going to take place. The cyclic AMP dependent PKC is generally, it is what having its an in major intracellular receptor for cyclic AMP binding of cyclic AMP causes dissociation of regulatory subunits as a result of 10,000 to 1 lakh fold decrease in affinity of R or C with resultant activation of the catalytic subunit. This is about the binding of the adrenaline or norepinephrine and subsequent events taking place. Especially, there is a change or configuration of the receptor and the phosphorylation of various cellular proteins then causes responses that are characteristic of those produced by beta adrenergic agonists. So then when the stimulus is removed, suppose you have removed the adrenaline from its action site, then dephosphorylation of the various protein substances, substrate is catalyzed by phosphoprotein phosphatases. So a well-defined example of this mechanism is activation of hepatic glycogen phosphorylase. This is an enzyme, hepatic glycogen phosphorylase. So the enzyme promotes the rate limiting step in glycogenolysis, the conversion of glycogen to glucose 1 phosphate. So the example is activation of hepatic glycogen this phosphorylase enzyme promotes the conversion of glycogen to 1 glucose 1 phosphate and ultimately glucose is formed. So this activation itself is a result of cascade of reactions, and especially the cyclic AMP dependent PKC catalyzes the phosphorylation of PKC, thereby activating it phosphokinase and then phosphorylates and activates the phosphorylase enzyme. And this sequence of successive phosphorylations permits considerable amplification of the initial signal. And because of this thing, only a few receptors need to be stimulated to activate a large number of the phosphorylase molecule in a very brief period. See, we are understanding that all the receptors need not be activated by the norepinephrine itself. Instead, only few of the receptors may also be activated by a specific transmitter, and there is initiation of the post-junctional activity. And concurrent with the activation of hepatic glycogen phosphorylase, cyclic AMP mediated protein kinase also catalyzes the phosphorylation and inactivation of another enzyme, that is the glycogen synthase, which catalyzes the transfer of glycosyl units from UDP glucose to glycogen. So here concurrent stimulation of the hepatic glycogen phosphate and also the glycogen synthase, ultimately these are going to catabolize the body store of the especially glucose from liver and glucose 1 phosphatase. This effect decreases the net rate of synthesis of glycogen from glucose. So especially in case of glycogenolysis process, whenever there is a fight or flight respect is there, then lot of pool of the glucose is released by all the above said mechanisms. The dual effect of cyclic AMP to enhance conversion of this glycogen to glucose and to decrease the synthesis of glycogen from glucose summit, they increase the output of glucose from liver. So whenever there is a glucose requirement, what are all the processes, what are all the storehouses? The number one storehouse is the glucose, followed by the muscle glucose, then by the adipose tissue glucose. And similar type of the reaction result in activation of triglyceride lipase in adipose tissues. The another depot of the glucose is adipose tissues, and adipose tissues there will be lipolysis and resultant increased release of free fatty acids. And the lipase is activated when it is phosphorylated by the cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase C. So these mechanisms are little bit what you call as exhaustive and complicated, but you should know how the glucose is produced when there is a fight and flight reflex to combat the body requirement of the glucose. And catecholamines provide an increased supply of the substrate for oxidative metabolism by the mechanism. So heart is an organ which need to act continuously, especially What happens? The stimulation of beta 1 type of the adrenergic receptors leads to positive inotropic and chronotropic action. Means what happens? Positive inotropic and chronotropic means the cardiac rate and force of contraction both are going to increase. The increased intracellular concentration of cyclic AMP and enhanced phosphorylation of proteins such as troponin and phospholamban are detected after beta adrenergic stimulation. So that the specific proteins like troponin and phospholamban are detected, especially in different tissues. And the cyclic AMP is an important thing in case of the beta adrenergic receptors. So the all these phosphorylation processes are ultimately disposition of the cellular calcium, and there will be intracellular events are going to take place, and positive inotropic response and positive chronotropic response, and both of these are sensitive to calcium channels by G stimulatory protein. See, you may be surprising that the same alpha and beta type of the receptors are existing in so many tissues, but the actions are different. This is because the distribution of the subtype of the receptors in different tissues. The alpha adrenergic receptors, there are six distinct type of the receptors, especially alpha adrenergic receptor genes have been cloned, and three at alpha 1 and three at alpha 2 genes. Already we know that alpha 1A, alpha 1B and alpha 1D, whereas alpha 2 ABCD. There are another three type of the genes, and nowadays alpha 4D are also there, and all the deduced amino acid sequences conform to well established paradigm of seven membrane spanning G protein. So the G protein is seven membrane spanning, while not as though investigated with the beta adrenergic receptors, the general structure features and the relation to the functions of ligand binding and G protein activation appear to agree with those set forth above for the beta adrenergic receptors. And it is already the action of the alpha adrenergic receptor do vary to great extent when compared to the beta adrenergic receptor, because the relation between the function and ligand binding, both of these are interrelated. So the membrane spanning domains, three alpha receptors, alpha 1A, 1D, 1, alpha 1A, B and D, three type of the subtype of the alpha 1 receptors, whereas the three type of the alpha 2 adrenergic receptors are no more similar. They are not at all similar, and A and B subtypes, alpha and beta subtypes, approximately 30% to 40%, and variety of the effector cells are distributed throughout the body, and inhibition of a ultra adrenergic receptors. What happens? The alpha adrenergic receptor coupled on adrenal cyclase activity was the earliest effect observed, but in some system the adrenal cyclase activity is actually stimulated by alpha 2 receptor, either by G inhibitory BG subunits or by weak direct actions on the G stimulatory proteins. And the physiological significance of these later especially processes is currently not clear. Of course, the alpha 2 adrenergic receptor activate G protein gated potassium channel, resulting in membrane hyperpolarization. So whenever the activation of potassium channel, it is a voltage gated process. Usually it is also having the pump, because the concentration gradient outside is less when compared to the inside, and the potassium ions are thrown out and the hyperpolarization status is maintained. So what happens? Because of this process, there is a dephosphorylation and resensitization of the receptors, and down regulation means the receptor population decreases to longer term desensitization of receptor function, and out-of-play is mediated by several distinct processes, and these include changes in the rate of receptor turnover, receptor gene transcription, and receptor of mRNA turnover. And these processes are very much complex and poorly understood at present. So this is enough for our knowledge. That means the overall the structure activity relationship is the G proteins, G inhibitory, G stimulatory, and GQ, and so many other proteins do have a different structures. However, the what you call as the neurotransmitters, also this norepinephrine, he says, and epinephrine, they have a unique structure, but they will bind with the varied structure of the receptors and elicit different type of the activity. And what is the relationship between the nervous system and the enteric and the especially endocrine system? Especially the nervous system and endocrine system have got direct relationships, because the humors, means the chemicals, are secreted at certain sites to act elsewhere in the body can be traced to Aristotle. It's a very old concept that the humor, neurohumoral transmission, means humors are involved in the nervous transmission. That's why in modern terms, the theory of neurohumoral transmission, by its very distinguishing, implies at least the superficial resemblance between the nerves and the endocrine system. So there is a very clear-cut, what you call as the relationship between the endocrine system and nervous system. Already it's very well established. So it is clear that the similarities extend considerably deeper, particularly with respect of autonomic nervous system. So the relationship between the voluntary nervous system is less, whereas the relationship between the autonomic nervous system and endocrine system do have a great relationship. And in the regulation of the homeostasis, the autonomic nervous system is responsible for rapid adjustments to change the total environment. It affects us both at its ganglionic synapses and postganglionic terminals by the liberation of chemical agents that act transiently at their immediate sites of release. So the homeostasis is the one of the thing called as the resting state of any what you call as a system. And the autonomic nervous stimulation causes rapid adjustments to the situation. Suppose a fright and flight reflex, the person has to adjust very fastly. Then this is possible because both the ganglionic synapses and postganglionic terminals do liberate the what you call as the neurotransmitter, and they are stored in the storage vesicles. The endocrine system regulates slower, more generalized adaptations by releasing the hormones into systemic circulation to act distinct widespread site over the period of minutes to hour and days. Here the endocrine system is little bit different. For example, the oxytocin acts very fastly on the uterus, whereas the growth hormone takes long time to act. The half-life of each hormone is totally different from one to each other. Whereas the most of the time, the neurotransmission occurs within a very fast, what you call as the track. And the central representations of the both system, autonomic system and endocrine systems, are connected with the central nervous system through that of the hypothalamus, where they are integrated with each other and with subcortical, cortical, and spinal influences. Different areas of the brain are what you call as controlling the activity of the endocrine secretion and the relationships. The neurohumoral theory thus may said to provide a unitary concept of functioning of the nervous and endocrine systems. So in which the differences largely relate to distance over which the release mediators travel. So here, earlier it was thought that the neurotransmitter is released in the central nervous system. It will travel throughout the nerves and it is going to the action. But nowadays, it's very clear that the neurotransmitters are stored already in the presynaptic vesicles, and whenever there is a change in the electrical electrical voltage change, then they are going to be increased intracellular calcium then the activation of the docking complex, then there is fusion of the vesicles, ultimately exocytosis occurs, and this happens within a fraction of milliseconds. So this is the recent concept, whereas the earlier concept was not like that. And few of the pharmacological consideration. Our interest, yes, we have understood different steps, how a nerve impulse is generated, how it is going to be transmitted, that's the axonal conduction. Then this is junctional transmission. All these processes are there in the normal physiological condition. And being the pharmacologist, how we can interfere with this process to get the desired effect, desired pharmacological effect. That's why in this section presents a classification of drugs that act on the peripheral nervous system and its effector organs at some stage of the neurotransmission. So here yesterday we will recall this, because these steps of synthesis of the norepinephrine and epinephrine, the DOPA to dopamine, are very, very important always. Hence, we will learn them very carefully. Okay. So, the tyrosine, you know the structure of this tyrosine, and with the help of the enzyme tyrosine hydroxylase is the enzyme. Then this happens in the liver, which is phenylalanine is converted to tyrosine. Phenylalanine in the liver is converted to tyrosine with the help of the what you call as hydroxylase enzyme. Dopamine, beta hydroxylase, and tyrosine with tyrosine hydroxylase enzyme, it is going to convert the tyrosine to dopamine. DOPA, with DOPA decarboxylase enzyme, it is converted to dopamine. Dopamine beta hydroxylase converted the dopamine to noradrenaline, and noradrenaline with the phenylmethylene N-methyltransferase enzyme, it is going to convert the norepinephrine to adrenaline. So this happens in adrenal medulla cells, especially conversion of norepinephrine to epinephrine, and ultimately epinephrine is stored in the chromaffin cells of the adrenal medulla. And under the influence of the corticosteroids, the adrenaline is released to greater extent.